بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عباده الذين اصطفى. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters and dearest listeners, tonight we read the opening verses of the 11th para or the chapter of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of those who presented excuses for not having attended the battle of Tabuk. That was a battle wherein all the mu'mineen were supposed to come out besides those who had valid excuses. Last night we read a verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of those who are weak who were excused. Those who had other valid excuses who did not have to attend. But there were some people who didn't attend and they did not have an excuse. And they thought that the mu'mineen might not win at this time. And when the mu'mineen returned to Al-Madinatul Munawwara, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the excuses that these people would come up with. يَعْتَذِرُونَ إِلَيْكُمْ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ قُلْ لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا لَنْ نُؤْمِنَ لَكُمْ قَدْ نَبَّأَنَا اللَّهُ مِنْ أَخْبَارِكُمْ. When you get to them, they will present excuses to you. Tell them, don't present excuses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already informed us about your news. We will not believe in what you have to say. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can always be found in His obedience. And not from amongst those who are found in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was a man at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, make dua for my business. Make dua that I have barakah in my business. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obviously informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam much more than anyone else. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, I fear that if I make a dua for your business, you might become oblivious of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept you with a little bit less so that you can turn to the Creator. So he said, no, I promise and I guarantee if Allah gives me wealth, I'm going to spend it in His path. Let's listen very carefully. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a dua for him. That, oh Allah, grant this man. He was granted the same day, it is reported like worms. Like all worms happen to multiply. That is how his business began to grow the same day. And it was so big that he had to shift out of Al-Madinatul Munawwara with all his livestock and so on. And he was a man who used to read 5 salah a day. After some time, he began to read 3. After some time, he left those 3. He used to come only for Jumu'ah. After some time, even that he stopped. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked the companions, where is this man? And he was told that, you know, this man, ever since he's become rich, he's forgotten Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at that time, zakat was not compulsory. It was only voluntary. But one day, the verses of zakat were revealed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses which made zakat compulsory. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent some people, some of his companions, go to this man and tell him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has now made it compulsory for you to give some wealth in his cause. So they went. They left Al-Madinatul Munawwara and on the outskirts they found him and they said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has sent us to you and he has told us that we should come and get wealth from you because zakat is compulsory and this is the verse. They read the verse of the Quran. He scratched his head and he said, no. It can't be. Who else are you going to go to? Is there anyone else you were sent to? They said, yes, we were sent to 2 people, yourself and another man. So he said, go to that man and then on your way back, let's see what I can do for you. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, these people went to the other man. The other man was a Sulami. He was also one of the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As soon as the verse was read, he came out with the best of his wealth, the best of his camels. And he said, take this in the path of Allah. Take this as zakah. And they informed him that, look, we are not supposed to take the best of your wealth. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, اِتَّقِ كَرَائِمَ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Stay away from the best of the wealth. Take that which is mediocre. Not the worst and not the best. The middle. So he gave and he said, no, I want to give this. I want to give it. Allah has given me all that I have and I want to give it. And on their way back, after having collected all this, they passed by that man once again. And he saw it and he said, listen, I've decided I'm not giving you. You can go. Do what you want. All this wealth here is mine. Allahu Akbar. So Allah makes mention of that. We read the verse last night, but it's connected to tonight's verses. So let me read the verse we read. ومنهم من عاهد الله لئن آتانا من فضله لنصدقن ولنكونن من الصالحين. From amongst the people are those who promise Allah that if we get wealth, then we will definitely give our charities and we will be from amongst the righteous.
فلما آتاهم من فضله بخلوا به وتولوا وهم معرضون.
Then when they got the wealth, they became stingy and they turned away. Allahu Akbar. Allah speaks of this incident here in the Quran. Then Allah says,
فَأَعْقَبَهُمْ نِفَاقًا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ إِلَى يَوْمِ يَلْقَوْنَهُ بِمَا أَخْلَفُوا اللَّهَ مَا وَعَدُوهُ وَبِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ.
As a result, Allah says, we instilled hypocrisy in that man's heart up to the day of Qiyamah because of the fact that he turned away, he reneged and he lied. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Whenever we promise Allah, we must fulfill the promise, no matter what. Sometimes we make a promise in our business that, Ya Allah, 20% I'll give for your cause. We start off with 100 rands, so 20 rands is nothing. But when you get to 100 million, then 20 million means a lot. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. But when it gets to that, that is the test of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't want to be like these who fail the test. So that man's wealth was never accepted. After that, one of his relatives was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when this verse was revealed. He rushed to this man and he says, you know what? There's a verse that was revealed in your case and now you are going to be declared a hypocrite. So he ran with the best of his wealth to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you know what? You've come with the wealth now. Allah has prohibited me from taking it from you. Allah does not need this wealth. He cried and he begged day after day, year after year. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left the dunya and he still begged Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not take it, who am I? The same happened at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab. If he didn't take it, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu didn't take your wealth, who am I? And the same happened at the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And this man happened to pass away at the time of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. May Allah save us. Now let's see how his wealth was used. Because we know he had lots of wealth. So now, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was a man known as Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. And this man, he was a hypocrite. He was not a Muslim, but he pretended to be a Muslim. He entered the ranks of the Muslimin and he spied and he wanted to split and so on the Muslims because they were about to choose him as the leader of Medina before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hijrah. And when the hijrah happened, he lost out, so to speak. So he was always against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he decided, you know, there is a Masjid Quba, there is Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi. I need to try and make an army of people who are weak. I can't get Abu Bakr, I can't get Umar, I can't get those who are solid and strong in Iman. But those who are accepting Islam now, recently, meaning newly, let me try and build a masjid, just me, a Masjid Quba. And when they come for Salah there, I will contaminate their minds. So he built a masjid. And it was close to the time of the Battle of Tabuk. And he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where did he get the money from to build that masjid? Where did he get the wealth from to build that masjid? One of the biggest contributors was that man. That man whose wealth was rejected in the good cause, Allah used his wealth in an evil cause to split and divide the Muslim ummah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does this to everyone who becomes arrogant when they become wealthy. When we become wealthy, we must learn to come down to earth. And we must make dua to Allah, Ya Allah, use our wealth in the right path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need wealth. When we go to a certain cause and we say, listen, I'm stopping today, it might not be I am stopping today, it might be Allah doesn't want your wealth from today, He wants to use somebody else's wealth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. So, this man had used his wealth, they built a masjid. And they told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, come and bless this masjid of ours. They knew that he wouldn't come to read salah there all the time, but if he came once, it was enough. And then all the weak people would come there and it was a point of convenience for them. And then they would be contaminated and the ummah would be divided into two. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, during the battle of Tabuk, on their way back, verses were revealed to inform Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding the reality of this masjid. It was termed Masjid Dirar, the Masjid of Harm.
وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مَسْجِدًا ضِرَارًا وَكُفْرًا وَتَفْرِيقًا بَيْنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَإِرْصَادًا لِمَنْ حَارَبَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَلَيَحْلِفُنَّ إن أردنا إلا الحسنى.
الله أكبر. Those who took a masjid, who built a masjid in order to harm the Muslim Ummah as a form of disbelief and disuniting the Muslim Ummah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that though they will promise oaths by Allah that wallahi we only intended goodness, وَلَا يَحْلِفُنَّ إِنْ أَرَدَنَا إِلَّا الْحُسْنَى, we only intended goodness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
لَا تَقُمْ فِيهِ أَبَدًا,
don't ever set foot in that masjid, never, don't bless it.
لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى مِنْ أَوَّلِ يَوْمٍ أَحَقُّ أَن تَقُومَ فِيهِ.
That masjid, Masjid Quba, which is right near there, that was built from day one with taqwa, with unity, with the involvement of the whole community, the whole ummah, that masjid is much better for you to stand in than a masjid which was a little show for one particular person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. It was called a masjid, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed to order some of his companions to go out and destroy it. They literally burnt it and destroyed it. So this is mentioned in the Quran. The question is, why is the story here? Do we think it's here for no reason? Is it a pastime? Is it something that we just need to read and smile about or say, yes, those people were fixed? No, it is for us in our own societies, our own communities. Remember, the ummah is one ummah. It is a brotherhood. Any collective activity that is meant to be beneficial for the entire ummah must be done with consensus of the ummah, or at least by consulting the senior ulama of the ummah or the society or community around us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. There is a trend across the globe. When I have a problem with something in this masjid, I'll build my masjid right next door. Then somebody will have a problem with me, they will build their masjid another door down. Until we have 1,000 masajid on the same street. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. By doing this, we are splitting the Muslim ummah. Yes, if there is a need and the fathers of the community see that there is a need, and it is not the depletion of the resources of the ummah, then alhamdulillah, it is permissible, it is allowed, because the one masjid is full, now we will build another one. One is very far off, now we want to build another one quite a distance away, because the Muslims need to read salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to understand. It's very important that we go and read these verses, the English of it, and think of how it applies to me and you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect.